The following program is brought to you by Arlington Community Media, where we tell your story.
This is ACMi News, recognized nationwide as the first place winner of the 2023 Hometown Media Award for News Access.
From McLennan Park to Spy Pond, from Poets Corner to the Mystic River, we have Arlington covered, giving you stories that count from people who care. Reliable, trustworthy, dependable. This is the nationwide award-winning ACMi News.
Hello and welcome to this special holiday edition of ACMi News. I'm Jeff Barn. This time of the year, we all celebrate in one way or another, and in our own way. So for the next half hour or so, we thought we'd celebrate the creative genius of one of Arlington's own, the world-renowned sculptor, Cyrus Edwin Dallin. That's why I'm here at the Dallin Museum at 611 Mass Ave. Now, for a good portion of the year 2023, ACMi News partnered with this museum to piece together a major project which focuses on the many sides of this master artist. Between May and November of this year, we produced an oral histories program. Area residents reading firsthand accounts of people who came in contact with Cyrus Dallin and really have a fascinating story to tell. Our first part of this series focuses on Cyrus Dallin's house and studio right here in Arlington, more specifically Arlington Heights. It's where Cyrus Dallin conceived, designed, and created some of his most iconic works. The appeal to the great spirit in front of Boston's Museum of Fine Arts, the Paul Revere statue in the North End, and the Massasoit sculpture in Plymouth, Mass. Just a few works by Arlington's own master craftsman, Cyrus Edwin Dallin. This story is read by Dallin's great-granddaughter, Pat McCabe.
I'm going to be reading today from an oral history of Cyrus Dallin and his home that was written by my mother, Ruth Dallin McCabe Stevenson. She was the granddaughter of Cyrus and Victoria Dallin. Her writings have been edited slightly just to make them flow a little better, but it's pretty much all her own words. So it begins. His house was at the corner of Oakland Avenue and Cliff Street. She notes that Cliff Street was a well-known named street because it was full of cliffs, rocky cliffs. The house had steps leading up from the sidewalk to a wide porch that went almost all around the house. One end was screened and furnished with porch furniture. His house was 69 Oakland Avenue, and across the street was our house at 84 Oakland Avenue. One entered through a glass entry where outside footwear was deposited. Another door opened into a wide hall. To the left was the music room, and to the right, the drawing room. This room curved following the curve of the porch. Back of the drawing room was the dining room with the butler's pantry connecting the dining room to the kitchen. From the hall, one climbed a wide staircase to the landing, which had a suit of armor and my grandmother's cedar chest. Grandpa put an Indian mask for a face on the armor, and at night I was terrified to go by it. The guest bedroom was on the left, and then the library. It had a round table over which hung a big Tiffany lamp. A large fireplace, bookcases lined the wall. Many of the books were about Indians or written by Indians. His desk was in the corner overlooking the street. Here he wrote business letters and letters to friends and relatives. I might note that he had many letters from his family asking for money. So much of his money went out to Utah to help family members. He also built a house for his mother in Springville. She originally was living in a two-room cabin and raised all of her children in that cabin. So when he could, he built her the house. Cyrus read extensively and loved this room. It was here that he liked to play cards in front of the fire. It was usually a simple game like double canfield. He made up the rules, and we played by his rules. Naturally, he won, And although we knew he cheated, we let him win. I really think he did this to see if we would let him get away with it. And we always let him. So he was happy. My grandmother's sewing room was between the library and the master bedroom. The third floor had a large billiard table and his bows and arrows, as well as his target. For relaxation, he would either play billiards or use his bows and arrows. About the first thing I remember about my grandparents was being taught to read by my grandmother. She chose as a text the Song of Hiawatha by Longfellow. I can still remember the opening lines, and I remember as a child she used to quote those lines to me. It stayed with her all of her life. Her grandmother had been a school teacher. When she and my grandfather were courting, he would write her from Utah and she would return his letters correcting the spelling and grammar. He never resented this and used her suggestions in subsequent letters. My grandmother, whom he referred to as his little Dresden doll, smoothed his rough edges and he could converse with family and clients with ease. I remember him as a polished, well-spoken gentleman. As she was a teacher, and as his schooling was very limited, her assistance helped him immeasurably. I remember him speaking perfect English, and as he had beautiful manners, he was able to hold his own with others and in time with clients. He always said he got his love of beauty from his mother. His father worked a small gold mine, and because he resigned from the Mormon church, he was unable to hire Mormon workers, so he had to depend on his sons. Thus, one day, when Cyrus was helping to remove clay from the mine, he molded his first head. Now for my remembrances of the studio. It was only a short distance from the house. It was a fairly long wooden structure attached to the garage. One gained entrance by going up a couple of steps and turning right and entering through a door. A big cherry tree guarded the entrance. On entering, the first thing one would see would be a large wooden box holding his plasticine, the medium he used to make his models. As your eye scanned the room, you would see several pedestals holding figures on them, a bust of his mother and father in marble, a World War I figure. It may have depicted my uncle Arthur as he was an ambulance driver during that war, Abraham Lincoln, and others that I cannot name now. His working table had a top that could be turned easily. You might even see him on a ladder with a larger-than-life piece. He had a pail of plasticine on the paint shelf. Of course, he worked from an armature, loading that with medium and working away to refine the piece with his modeling tools. This was the room the boys came into after school. Many afternoons, my husband's cousins were among the group. He handed each of them a hunk of plasticine and told them to make something with it, but be quiet and let him work. They all loved him and called him Grandpa Dallin, as did everyone in the neighborhood. At my 50th high school reunion, several of the men came up to me and recalled the days they spent at his feet. He always worked in a greenish smock, wore a tam that my grandmother crocheted for him. She kept him supplied with tams. My grandmother started a hobby club for the boys, and my father and other neighborhood kids belonged. My father developed a keen interest in radio, and not only was a hobby, but he used it in his business life also. He had many inventions dealing with radios, including transistor radios and radar. And I remember as a kid when we went to visit my grandmother and grandfather, he was always on his radio. It was one of the enduring hobbies that he had. My grandmother also started the women's club and the study club. My grandparents were entertained a great deal. So in order to repay these social obligations, she would have formal teas. We three girls were asked to help by handing around cups of tea and passing cookies and cakes. My grandfather always attended, and he would always take a group through the studio. Thanksgiving was celebrated at their house. My father had to drive to Beacon Hill to pick up Grandma's two sisters, and as long as he lived, the brother also. One of my great aunts couldn't resist needling grandmother, who would burst into tears and have to leave the table. We had about 13 at the table and only one maid. And as grandma insisted on formal service, it took a long time to be served. When we were old enough, we helped by passing vegetables, etc. Finger bowls always completed the dinner. I forgot to tell you that he placed an Indian on the high cliff at the back of the garden called, I think, the Last Arrow. It was only plaster, but it stayed there for several years before it literally washed away. We did have many cliffs around. I think he selected the property because it reminded him of his beloved Wasatch Mountains in Utah. He painted these mountains several times. Perhaps I can tell you a bit about the man. He was not very tall and he used a cane only to point at something. I told you about the time at the art museum when he shook his cane and said, "That's not art." Many Sunday afternoons, we would drive Grandpa and our family to the art museum and follow him around, listening to him talk about the paintings. A group of people always followed us. Another example of how he interacted with children in the neighborhood, he came upon a group of boys throwing stones in the woods, and he said to them, "See how I throw?" And then he proceeded to draw a circle on one of the trees and throw a stone, hitting the middle of the target. The boys thought that looked like fun and tried it, and decided that was what they wanted to do. Coming home at night from the art museum, he would wait at Harvard Square for the Arlington Heights trolley car, or streetcar. I also used to take the same streetcar. He usually got there before I did, so when I got on, no seats. I would spot him and hold on to the back of his seat so we could talk. He would not let me stand. After I said no a couple of times, he said, "A gentleman never sits when a lady is standing." So that was that. After we got to the last stop at Arlington Heights, we would walk home together. My mother was a good cook, and when she made an apple pie, she would phone Grandpa to say his piece was waiting for him, so he would come over and enjoy a piece of pie and cheese. My mother always ate cheese with her apple pie. My grandmother would not serve apple pie. She considered it plebeian. Many times I would go over in the afternoon and check what they were having for dinner. If it was better than our menu, I'd call home and tell mother I was staying for dinner. So you see, there was a lot of travel between the two houses. He told a story about a trip east with a chief and many of his Indians. After they went through the first tunnel, Grandpa looked around. No Indians. All, including the chief, were under their seats. Grandpa tried to explain to the chief using sign language. So after the second tunnel, the chief was sitting, grabbing the arms of the seats so hard, his hands were white, and all the other Indians were again under their seats. They were going to see the Great White Father in Washington. He and Martin Bovey were close friends and traveled one year to Utah together. Martin lived next to us and he skied our driveway and built a jump at the end. When Arthur started his stained glass business, he used part of the studio. First, he built a second floor over the garage, which he used for his office and workroom. He hung the cartoons for display. Then, if accepted, he would cut the glass on a long table on the floor of the garage. His kiln was on the back wall of the garage. The glass was painted on to get the proper colors he needed, and then it was fired in the kiln, taken out, leaded, and returned to the kiln. He had a flourishing business. When the Second World War broke out, and because he was a French citizen as well as an American, he chose to heed the call to the colors. He was 40 years old and too old to join the regular French army, so he joined the French Foreign Legion. He was killed and left a family who mourned him, and he was lost also to the art world. My grandparents never got over his needless death. They tried to stop him from going, but of course didn't succeed. He never married. It just left the rest of the family to miss him. Ruth Dallin Stevenson.
And we wish to thank Dale Peterson and his family for graciously allowing us access to their Arlington Heights home. It is the very home indeed where Cyrus Dallin once lived and where he worked. Cyrus Dallin was not your typical everyday eccentric recluse of an artist. He was quite accessible to his neighbors and really the public in general. He actually allowed the children of the community to visit his studio while he was working. One such child, Katherine Xenos, wrote about one such experience in her diary, and luckily, we still have one particular entry preserved now for all time.
Tuesday, October 1st, 1940. Dear Diary, after school today, I went with a group and my art teacher to Mr. Dallin's house. He is a great sculptor who has made the statue of Massasoit that is in Plymouth, Mass., and the Indian medicine man, the appeal to the Great Spirit, that's in front of the Boston Art Museum, and a statue of Paul Revere that he just sold to Boston. He was a kind old man, 79 years old. He told us about his childhood days, how he played with Indians. He loved Indians, and as a boy, always played with Indian children. He said Indians are the kindest people, and they always have a dog. He also said that the Indians consider it a crime to whip a child. Indians would kill people because we never had a flag which they considered as a peace flag. He had a statue of his mother and father and a painting of himself that he did and many little statues. He was making a model of a knight with armor on a horse. It was of stuff almost like clay, the challenge. He was a kind old man and I'll never forget him. He lives in Arlington Heights, Massachusetts.
Our next story focuses on Cyrus Dallin's relationship with the indigenous peoples here in North America, going all the way back to when he was a child in the state of Utah more than a century ago. It's a respect he carried for Native Americans his entire life, and the love was reflected in Dallin's own majestic works. This story is read by Dallin Museum board member Geri Tremblay.
Does every Pilgrim Hall docent have a favorite artifact? Mine is a small statue of Massasoit, the miniature version of the towering Coles Hill landmark. The little museum figure touches me for its grace, its lithe youthfulness, and something more. When I stand before it, I'm transported to an ice blue studio and a magical afternoon with Cyrus Dallin, the sculptor. The Dallins lived in Arlington Heights, Massachusetts, just a few doors from my mother's family. The parents were friends. The kids all scuffled downhill to school together. One October in the early 1930s, my mother and I were in Arlington visiting my grandparents. The Dallins, being especially fond of my mother, asked us to tea. Mrs. Dallin greeted us at the door, a chilly lady, cold roast Boston, dressed in the style of Queen Mary with a collar of filigree lace. She ushered us into a room full of antiques, spindly chairs, frail tables, eggshell china, a minefield for a clumsy, nearsighted child struggling to unstrap the red buttons on my brown leather gloves. I could only hope for invisibility. On the far side of the room, a man rose from a rocking chair. This, I know, was Arthur Dallin, my mother's particular childhood pal. Arthur had been an ambulance driver in France in World War I and still suffered from badly frozen feet. "He hobbles," my grandmother cautioned. "Don't stare, ducky." Between the tea ceremony and grown-up talk, Arthur, a distinguished stained glass artist, was talking about his latest project. I sneaked a peek at his shoes. They were definitely odd, deeply cracked, laced high over his ankles, but polished to a fierce gloss. Just then, the parlor door opened. In trotted a small man, neat little pointed beard, rimless glasses. So ordinary, I was quite disappointed. He didn't look at all like an artist, let alone somebody who'd been born in a log cabin in Utah when it was Indian country. As soon as he recognized my mother, his face lit up. The moment tea was over, he swept us away from the parlor, down a long back corridor to his studio. At the door, he paused to don a smock and a beret, and so became, in a wink, the artist. Inside the studio, cavernous, blue in the October dusk, smelling of wet clay, another transformation, this time to wizard. He pranced around, waving his hands over swathed shapes, bodiless heads with blank eyes and chunks of white marble. I was invited to touch, but the deathly chill made me recoil with a shudder. The sculptor gave me a reassuring pat and asked if I ever played with clay. He explained he did because he had to practice before doing statues in marble. He then unwrapped several heads, mainly children, but I think accidentally revealed a male Native American's face, so tortured and tragic, I see it to this day in my dreams. Gradually, the spookiness of the place wore off. I could see the high work tables were filled with tools. This was a shop, not really so different from my inventor father's. As I wandered about, my mother asked Mr. Dallin if he remembered a long ago family picnic. It was a story I knew and loved. The party was arranged by Mrs. Dallin in honor of three Native Americans in the cast of the Buffalo Bill Wild West show, then touring Boston. All the children were invited. My mother and her four siblings brought the strawberry ice cream, which in those days had to be hand-turned. Hard work with a few fights over the dasher, but eventually everybody got a lick. At the party, the strawberry ice cream was a hit. However, Mr. Dallin's eyes fixed on Native Americans let his melt in the dish. The children were very shocked. How the little sculptured cowed with laughter, he told us that one of the Indians later modeled for him. Someone, perhaps Arthur Dallin, took photographs that summer day. I remember them as lovely, soft focus with silvery grasses on the hillside and the three visitors in native dress. They were such beautiful people, my mother said softly. By now the light had faded and it was time to go. Once again, I wrestled with the red button gloves and worried whether the occasion called for saying goodbye with a curtsy or a handshake. Cyrus Dallin solved the problem by gently taking my hand in both of his. Rustling through the oak leaves on the dark walk to my grandparents' house, somehow I lost a glove, the left one. "Never mind," said my grandmother. "It is the other one that touched the hand of a famous artist." For many decades, I kept that right glove. A decade later, things were sadly changed for the Dallins. The sculptor's work fell out of fashion. The gifted beloved son died fighting in France with the Foreign Legion in World War II. The heartbroken father did not long survive him. In 1945, the ice blue studio was destroyed by fire. Yet, out of so many losses, so long a neglect, another transformation. The works of Cyrus Dallin from Indian country are reaching a new generation. What he glimpsed of the Native American triumph and tragedy is a truth whose time has come.
Just a sample of our oral history series, which will be made available at the museum's website in the very near future. And we wish to thank everyone here at the Dallin Art Museum for giving us the honor of telling the heartfelt story of Cyrus Edwin Dallin. If you have yet to come to the museum, or if a lot of time has passed since your last visit here, you really need to return. And you can thank us at ACMI later. That'll do it for this special holiday edition of ACMI News. I'm Jeff Barn. Peace and joy and happy holidays to you all. And we will see you back here, of course, next week.
You can always check out our latest segments and newscasts on the web at acmi.tv/news. And don't forget to like us on Facebook and follow us on Twitter and Instagram at ACMI News. Make sure to subscribe to our YouTube channel as well. You'll find us at youtube.com/ACMI News. If you have any news tips for us or wish to become a citizen journalist, we'd love to hear from you. Email us at news@ACMI.tv or stop by ACMI Studio A at 85 Park Avenue.